Thank you to the Assyrian Democrats of the Bay Area for willing to host this event. My name is Lou Chiaramonte Jr. If my last name rings a bell, it's because my family owns the oldest family-owned food service business in the Bay Area, the Chiaramonte's Market in San Jose on 15th Street. I'm an alternative voting member on the Santa Cruz County DCC and a lead organizer for South Bay Indigenous Solidarity. I have a background in culture resource management, and I do have Indigenous American Amerindian ancestry myself. Mine is Cherokee. Many of you attending this meeting, my own ancestry is quite mixed. It goes back to many parts of Europe and even to the Mayflower as well. South Bay Indigenous Solidarity is a multi-ethnic group that supports Indigenous-led grassroots efforts to promote human rights, restore Indigenous land stewardship, and preserve threatened cultural, burial, and sacred sites. And our current focus is aiding the Amamutsun Tribal Band in its effort to preserve its most sacred ceremonial site, a place known as Huristak, which is a place of immense cultural, historical, environmental, and spiritual significance. I mentioned my own mixed ancestry because I know a lot of the folks attending tonight, have mixed ancestry that might include Amerindian ancestry. Now, those peoples who inhabited the Santa Clara County region or the greater San Francisco Bay Area at the time of Spanish colonization in the late 1700s are often referred to as Ohlone. And I'll go ahead and share a screen here quickly. As this map here of language families in North America shows, or north of Mexico shows, California was a very special region. You can see all of these language families, all of these distinct languages in this one region here. And that's partly because so many people lived in the region. The people who lived in California at the time that the Spanish came, the late 1700s, to set up the Mission Presidio Pueblo system actually were able to achieve very large populations without the use of intensive agriculture. Instead, the peoples here actively stewarded the land to create a greater abundance of crops that they could utilize. Not crops, but foodstuffs. And here's a map of California, just to give some context to the talk tonight, well, the tribal chair is presenting. And this highlights the area of the peoples who are now often referred to as the Ohlone. And within the area of the San Francisco Bay Area here, the Ohlone language had several major dialects, which could be considered distinct languages in themselves. And you can see the Mutsun dialect is outlined here. And this shows the location of Gilroy in relation to Mutsun speakers. This is another map to give you an idea of the languages in the region. So you have Mutsun in a lot of the southern part of Santa Clara County. You have Awaswas being the major language group in Santa Cruz County. And the Amamutsun Tribal Band, of which Valentin Lopez will be speaking tonight as the tribal chair, represents the descendants of those who were taken either to Mission San Juan Bautista, which would be in this area here, or Mission Santa Cruz. And that would include many of the peoples who traditionally lived in what is now the southern portion of Santa Clara County. Defining people by their language or language family is a rather generic way to go about things. This is a map that gives a bit more of an idea of the political complexity that existed at the time of Spanish colonization in the late 1700s. And each one of these names on this map, and I'll zoom in so you can see some of them closer, would be basically a distinct language group. A person living in Yupi territory would not necessarily be able to understand a person living in Tamien territory. Anthropologists often refer to these groups as tribalists. Now, it's important to understand that as the tribal chair will present tonight, he will describe how the population of this region, the ancestors of the Amamutsun, were basically reduced by 98%. 98% of their population was wiped out between the late 1700s and the year 1900. And the primary reason I'm speaking to you tonight, just sort of give an overview of the area from a cultural perspective, an outsider's cultural perspective, is to, you know, really bring home the point that as you're listening to the presentation this evening, you know, keep in mind this isn't just a sad history. This is, you know, colonialism never really ended here. None of the lands in Santa Clara County were ever formally ceded by the indigenous inhabitants of the county. And the stewardship of these lands, both in terms of the natural ecology on the lands, as well as of the many thousands of burial, cultural, and sacred sites that exist within Santa Clara County alone, is of great importance to the descendants of those who actually created these sites, who actually revered these sites for thousands of years. You know, there are laws that give some consideration to these quote unquote cultural resources. Oftentimes they're laws that are generally termed cultural resource management laws, but they're tied in with things like CEQA and NEPA and other environmental laws out there. But they only get enacted when people are, or acted upon when people either report finding something or when they're filing for a permit. When you file for a permit, your government agency will check with the regional state information system to see if the area is archaeologically sensitive and if it requires an archaeologist to do a study before any permit is issued or construction is undertaken. Sometimes in construction projects, you'll have monitors, either archaeologists and or members of most likely descendant groups, tribal groups, tribal monitors, actually watching the construction going on to pick out if any cultural resources are being disturbed. It's very difficult to identify a burial if bones have been scattered either by the things living in the ground, a process we call bioturbulation, or by the way the body was actually interred. Many people were partially cremated in this area. And so it is important to remember that these sites do exist in very large quantities all around the county, all around the country, of course, and that we as residents in the region can do what we can to ensure that if we're disturbing the ground, if we're disturbing these ancestral lands, that some consideration is given to the cultural resources and to the rights of the indigenous descendants of those who actually lived on this land in the past. And if anyone attending tonight is involved in any government boards or open space preserves or anything else, I mean, you can use your voice to advocate that those organizations do reach out to the local tribal groups within their jurisdiction when it comes to projects that are being planned. You know, Assembly Bill 52 gives tribes a right to be part of the ethnographic studies for environmental impact reports. But again, the tribes themselves, the descendants of those who've lived here for thousands of years, are often unaware of a lot of the projects that are potentially affecting their ancestors, either cultural remains or physical remains, and their ancestral lands. So, you know, I do hope that after hearing from the tribal chair tonight, that is one thing that you all take home with you, is the fact that you know, genocide is a very broad term. It doesn't just mean the physical killing of an individual. It also means the destruction of the cultural remains that are important to a group. And, you know, keep in mind, too, that many people who lived and died in this region may have believed that disturbing their graves or their sacred items might negatively affect their version of an afterlife. And those are all concepts and questions that no one can say no one can really make an objective judgment on. So, without further ado, let me introduce Tribal Chair Valentin Lopez. One of three historic tribes that are recognized as Ohlone, the Amawutsun Tribal Band contains or is composed of the descendants of those who were taken to either Mission San Juan Bautista or Mission Santa Cruz. Valentin is Mutsun, Awaswas, Chumash, and Yokuts. The Amawutsun are comprised of the documented descendants of Mission San Juan Bautista and Santa Cruz. Valentin Lopez is a Native American advisor to the University of California, Office of the President. He's also a Native American advisor to the National Alliance on Mental Illness, or NAMI, and to the Phoebe Hearst Museum of Anthropology. Valentin is actively involved in efforts to restore tribal indigenous knowledge and ensure that the tribe's history is accurately told. Finally, Valentin is working to restore the Mutsun language and is a traditional Mutsun singer and dancer. As chairman, Valentin is a standing member of on all tribal committees and boards, and Valentin has spoken at the United Nations regarding the importance of Huristak, as well as other issues. So with that, I will pass the torch to Val, if he is on here and available right now.
I'm here, Lou. Thank you very much.
Good deal.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for inviting me to speak tonight. I truly appreciate it. It is an honor. And I enjoy speaking to other indigenous groups because indigenous people all have the same history and the same backgrounds. And we need to work together and support each other as best we can. So I appreciate the opportunity to speak tonight. The true history of the Native California's Indians has never been told. And I'm sure that's true for indigenous people around the world. The true history has never been told. And I'd like to tell a bit about that history tonight. First of all, I normally start with our creation story. Our creation story takes place at Mount Umanum, which was the tallest mountain peak in the Santa Cruz Mountains. You can see it if you're driving down Highway 101 in the San Jose area south. You can see Mount Umanum to the west. And it's that one that has those big military, that big military building at the top where they had the radar equipment on top of that. That is the place where our creation story takes place. And our creation story is very long. And the two most important things that I like to mention about it is that in our creation story, Creator very clearly told us where our tribal territory is. And so because of that, our people did not try to invade and take other territory to conquer or build empires or anything like that. When the creator told us what our territory was, we knew where we belonged. And we knew it was just wrong to go to anyone else's territory, so we did not do that. The second part of our creation story is, the second important part is that Creator gave us, the Amawutsun people, the responsibility to take care of Mother Earth and all living things within our territory. And we see that as a sacred obligation and a sacred responsibility given to us by Creator. And whenever we look at it today, we say that that obligation gives us moral authority. We are the only ones that have moral authority to speak for our lands. No one else does. With that directive from Creator, our people started learning about how to take care of Mother Earth. They knew that was a large responsibility. So they started learning how to take care of, for example, the plants. You know, they learned that all plants have a responsibility to take care of a full community. And that community included the fungi, the insects, the birds, the four-legged, and people. Every plant has that responsibility. And so that's how we stewarded our plants, so that they fulfilled that obligation. We did not, when our people started stewarding, looking at the plants and stuff like that, they saw where the plants were growing. And they recognized that that is where that plant wanted to grow. And they also recognized that that's where Creator put that plant. So we did not say this plant is beautiful, let's take it over here. Wouldn't it look better by the coast? Wouldn't it let it look better on this mountaintop? We did not do that. Those plants knew where they belonged. Why would we try and alter or change that? The way our people took care of the plants is that we would see where the plant is and then try and create bigger and bigger patches. And that patch, and the size of that patch would grow in proportion to the amount of the size of the community that it was taking care of. If it was an important food plant for the birds and stuff like that, as the bird populations grew, those patches grew. And the same for four-legged, et cetera. Or because of the way we stewarded the plants developed very deep root systems. A lot of the grasslands, the root systems will go down 15 to 20 feet deep. And that makes them very resistant to drought, to fire, to flooding. And because they had a responsibility to take care of a full community, they also developed the ability, strong resistance to disease. And that's much different than the other European grass plant life. The good example there is in the 1960s, there was an epidemic in the commercial vineyards, and all the vineyards, all the grapevines were dying. And they didn't know how they were gonna address that. But what they found out is that the rootstock from the California grape was very resistant to that disease and many others. And as a consequence of that, many of the vineyards around the world today have the rootstock from the California grape. The same is true for strawberry fields around the world, the commercial strawberry fields around the world. They all have the California rootstock of the California strawberry. And the same is true for many of the nut crops around the world. They have the rootstock from the California nuts and many other plants as well. So the way our ancestors took care of the plants was a very meaningful, purposeful, and an important way to steward those plants. Our people also learned how to use fire as a tool. We saw the plants as a gift to us from Creator. We saw fire, we see fire as a gift to us from Creator. That fire allowed us to have warmth, allowed us to have light, allowed us to cook our foods. And it was very important for ceremony. As we, fire is sacred to us. And whenever we have ceremony, if we're just saying prayers, we'll burn, we'll light sage, and we'll say a prayer into the sage, and the smoke from that sage will carry our prayers up to Creator. When we have ceremony, we'll have a fire pit there, and our dancers dance around the fire. And the people go to the ceremonies, they take their prayers, and they take their anxieties, and they take their cries and their pleads, et cetera, to these, and they give them up to the fire, and our dancers go around and collect the prayers and take them to the fire and deliver them So those prayers will be taken up to Creator. That's how our people dance, and that's what the purpose of all our ceremonies. All of our songs are ceremony or prayer songs. We do not have songs for amusement or for social activities. They were all prayer and ceremony songs. Our people took care of the coast. They learned how to take care of the resources there were there, and the habitat along the coast. A very important resource are the small fishes, the sardines, the anchovies, and other small fish. And those are particularly important here in California, is because whenever the salmon would migrate in, they don't just take off up the river. They need to transition from salt water to fresh water. And so so they'll come on in, and then they get they'll eat all, you know, they need those little fish to eat. And so to get their body weight on and to get their strength. And once they have that, and once they completed the transition to fresh water, then they start their migration up the river. And they're going opposite the current, you know, for a couple hundred miles or more. And that's very difficult. And so those habitats at the mouths of the river are very important. And our people focused on that and many other things, the shellfish, et cetera. Our people very effectively stewarded all Mother Earth. That's what our directive was. Our people did that for thousands of years. Here's something that I'd like everyone to know, is that the greater Bay Area, including, for example, Silicon Valley, was the most populated of indigenous people north of Mexico City. A lot of people don't realize that. That map that Lou showed you of all the languages and the tribes. In California, at first contact, there were over 400 tribes in California, and there were over 100 languages spoken in California. And those languages were as different as English is from Italian from Russian, for example, or Chinese. They were completely different. But that's 100 languages. This area here of California was the most linguistically diverse of all other places on Earth, with the exception of Papua New Guinea. I believe that's correct. That was the only other one. Our people had ceremonies to welcome for the migrating geese. We worked hard to prepare the habitats and the landscapes for the geese when they came in, to make sure they had plenty of resources. When the geese came in, they needed, they especially looked for insects, because that insects was protein for them. And so we made sure that we had, you know, the habitat, the wetlands, et cetera, that they were all prepared for the geese. So when they came in, there'd be a lot of insects for them, so they can have the insects and then continue their migration. We had ceremonies for the bear. We had ceremonies for the four seasons, that there would be balance in the four seasons, so we wouldn't get too much winter or too much rain, or so that we wouldn't get too much summer and then heat and drought. You know, so we would have ceremony to help, to ask Creator to please bring us balance in the four seasons. And there are many other practices that our ancestors learned and practiced for thousands of years. Indigenous people within our territory, remains have been found that date back 13,000 200 years, I believe that's it, but it is 200 years, 13,200 years But the ancestors go back way further than that. We have no doubt. And we say that, you know, since time immemorial, since the beginning of time, that's how far our people go back. And if you think of that in terms of generations, you know, that could be 800, 900, 1,000 generations or more. And, you know, with that directive to take care of Mother Earth and all living things, each generation learned a little bit more about how to take care of Mother Earth. And they passed that knowledge on to their children. So at first contact, there was a tremendous amount of knowledge of how to take care of Mother Earth, how to take care of the oceans, the wind, the fog, how to take care of the trees and the shadows, and et cetera. We did not try to change rivers. We did not build pyramids. We did not build statues. Creator made Mother Earth perfect. Why would we try to alter that? That's what we realized. The most important thing our people learned is that Mother Earth is sacred, and we had an obligation to maintain and ensure that Mother Earth remains sacred. Then came the brutal times of the mission period. There's a lot of horrible stories of the missions. The missions, first of all, when the missions came here, they came here to fulfill the directive of the papal bulls. There's a lot of papal bulls, but there was a number of them very specific to indigenous people. The two that I point out are the one in 1453. That papal bull was issued by Pope Alexander VI. And that papal bull said that all indigenous people all around the world, and if you're Assyrian, this applies to you. If all indigenous people or other indigenous people attending this meeting tonight, all indigenous people are heathens, pagans, and savages. It said that indigenous people had no soul. That is, to me, that is the one that I focus on the most. Because if you don't have a soul, that means you're not a human being. And if you're not a human being, they can enslave you. They can torture you. They can rape you. They can kill you. They can do whatever they want. And it's not a sin, because you are not a human being. By the way, the papal bulls that I'm talking about have never been rescinded or rejected. They continue to be the official doctrine of the Catholic Church, if you can believe that. The papal bulls of 1453 also said that all indigenous people are the enemies of Jesus Christ, that all indigenous people were to be put into perpetual slavery, and all indigenous people were to have their property and their possessions taken from them. That was a directive of the papal bull, and that's exactly what happened. A second papal bull that I talk about is known as the Doctrine of Discovery. And that was a papal bull issued by the Pope, and I forget which Pope, in 1493. And the Doctrine of Discovery was a directive for all the European Christian nations to go out and discover the new lands that were being found, to discover those new lands and to claim them for your European country. It could be Spain, it could be France, it could be Portugal, it could be England, whatever, you know, you name it. They went around the world and they discovered these lands. And then they were to discover these new lands, and then with the indigenous people, the indigenous people were to be, were to convert to both to be citizens of that country. They wanted them to be citizens of that country and to accept that the European way of living was better than any than the indigenous way of life, and they were to become Christians. And if they refused, and if they refused to become Christians, they were to be killed. That's a directive from the Pope. Isn't one of the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not kill? Why is the Pope saying that indigenous people must be killed if they do not assimilate? The reason is that indigenous people have no soul. That's a heavy one. That's a heavy one. And then right after that, they went out. Thank you. Then, okay, I said Alexander was the sixth. Thank you, Helen, Talia. Alexander the sixth was the Pope in 1493. Then I'm not sure who it was in 1453. And I'm sure that Helen will have the answer for us in a few minutes. Thank you, Helen. So whenever they came into California, the missions came into California, that right there was so that they could fulfill the obligations of the papal bulls. They were claiming this land for Spain. The indigenous people were to become citizens of Spain, and the indigenous people were to become Christians. And if they refused to accept that conversion or assimilation, they were to be killed. That's exactly what happened. Here in California, that's exactly what happened to indigenous people around the world. Why isn't this history ever taught in schools? At the missions were very brutal. When you came in, you know, Okay, thank you, Helen. Nicholas V was a Pope in 1453. Of the Indians, the way they would bring Indians to the missions is they would send soldiers out to capture them and bring them into the missions. They would tie them thumb to thumb and then march the Indians back to the mission. And there, once at the mission, they were slaves. They could not leave. If they tried to leave, they would send the soldiers out to capture them, and then they would give them whip. They would whip them every day for 30 days, give them 4 lashes every day for 30 days, and there would be public lashes to put fear and intimidation into the other Indians. From there, the Indians at the missions, they could not speak their language. They could not sing their songs. They could not, they had to learn Spanish and many other things. At the missions, they would separate the men from the children, the men from the children and from the women. And the reason for that is to try and force that conversion or that assimilation. Because if you were to accept if you're accepting European ways and the Christianity, then your tribe, then your family could be reunited. But if you did not accept that assimilation and conversion, then your family could never get together again. And that's the way the missions worked. The missions, it was just very hard labor. They did not use the horses as beasts of burdens, so the Indians were the hard labor. And they would go out and have to cut down trees in the forest and then carry them down, for example, the mission San Juan Bautista, which was a great distance. And it said that all the boys over age 10 had hernias. At the missions from the hard labor. And the women had to provide services. They separated the men from the women, from the children. The women, and each was kept in a separate barracks. At night, the soldiers would go in. The soldiers did not bring wives or female companions or girlfriends or anything like that. And so they would go into the women's barrack and rape them night after night after night. When you look at the mission records the birth records, for example, the mission records say father unknown, because they don't know who the father of that child was. Then we go to the Mexican period. There's a lot more atrocities that happened during that time. The population of the indigenous people that went to the missions was reduced by about 40% in total, about 40%. Under the Mexican period of time, the Mexican, they wanted to have the citizens here be Mexican citizens. And they realized that the Indians were not going to accept, convert to be citizens of Spain. And so what they did is they wanted to encourage citizens from Mexico to come on up. And so they were giving land grants. And they were giving those land grants, and then they would give them horses or cattle, sheep, pigs, etc., to turn that land into big ranchos. And so the people came on up, and so the indigenous land was lost under the Spanish period, and it was lost under the Mexican period. But then when they brought in the cattle, they bring in all their, they thought our grazing grasses, the indigenous grazing grasses, were inferior. And so they bring in the European grazing grasses, and they did not have to take care of that community that I talked about. And so they grow much faster. Much faster, and they quickly shaded out our native plants. Today, when you drive down Highway 1, Highway 101, 580, you name the freeway and look at the landscapes and the grasses and the plants that are there. Those are all 96% of them are non-native. So those plants represented our foods, our medicines, our basketry, our stuff for housing, for clothing, for childcare, for women's care, for dyes, for paints and ceremony, et cetera. I mean, all gone. That was followed by the American period. The American period was exceptionally brutal on Indians, and primarily the Indians in the Gold Rush territory. And so what happened is the gold was discovered, and then weeks after California became a state, California was created in 1848. And as a consequence of that, hundreds of thousands of people came to the United States in search of riches. And they were going up to the mountains and just tearing up those mountains. And so the Indians who were living there started to defend their territories and keep people out. All of a sudden, we have an Indian problem. And at this time, the governor of California, in his very first State of the Union, said that there will be a war of extermination against the California Indians that is to be expected. And then one of the very first treasury bonds that was passed by the state of California was a treasury bond to pay for the extermination of California Indians. And with that bond money, they paid for bounties, 25 cents to $5 bounty for every dead Indian. And they also paid militias to go up and search and find the Indians and to kill them. I know in Santa Clara County, in Santa Cruz County, that was happening. I'm sure that was happening in Santa Clara County, although I have no evidence or proof of that. I mean, I just believe that that happened there, and it happened throughout the state of California, because there's evidence that, for example, in Santa Cruz, the Santa Cruz newspaper in 1773, 21 years after they started paying bounty money, there was a posting in the San Jose Sentinel newspaper that said the county of Santa Clara will no longer pay bounties for Indian scalps. It was just a legal post there. It was listed there in Santa Cruz. They also passed laws of kidnapping of Indian children. They would kill the parents get the children, and then people would sell the children. This was an actual business. And over 10,000 Indians were kidnapped, and the vast majority of them were sold. And they would sell the boys for a lifetime of hard slave labor. And the girls, those people that came to California, the soldiers, the gold miners, a lot of those people that got those grants, they came, they didn't bring their families. They didn't bring, spouses or girlfriends or female companionship. And so they were buying little girls for female, for sexual reasons. And just little girls were being sold for that reason. And this right here was all state sponsored by California. They also passed the law of indentured servitude. And indentured servitude is slavery. And Indians would be indentured in California, which is, again, is it legalized slavery? People were indentured up until 1937. That's not that long ago. We had slavery, California slavery, here in California. That's a very brutal history. And that history is never told. That's why I say the true history of California Indians has never been told. And why hasn't it been told? It's very shameful. And wrong, and they just don't teach that. Throughout the 1900s, our people lived working from ranch to ranch to ranch. They would pick, pick a lot of crops, and a lot of the orchards, the prune orchards, the apricot orchards, the peaches, the nectarines, etc. They would pick that fruit. Then they would do the row crops, green beans and cucumbers and tomatoes. They would pick a lot of crops, and then they would go to, and then they would cross over the Pacheco Pass into the valley, and then they would do the grapes, and the grapes always gave you two seasons, one for picking grapes, and the second one was for pruning the vines. That was the second season of work for our ancestors. And they had a lot of cotton down in the Kings County, south of Fresno. And so our people would go down there and pick cotton. And then in the springtime, they would shear sheep. Certain ranchers, like in the Gilroy Hollister area, they knew that our people came from the missions there. And they would let us put up our tents on the missions and live there, And whenever we had seasonal work on those ranches, we would work on those ranches. And then we would leave to go stay at other ranches, but always in tents. But when there was no work to be had, we would go to their place and put the tents up. And so we appreciated that. That life continued up until 1965. By the way, I was born in 1952. In the first 5 years of my life, I lived in those tents and I went to that shearing camp and I picked cotton and picked grapes and I did that. And I say up until age five, because as a little kid, we went to work early. And then after that, we moved to, my dad went into construction in San Jose because construction was booming and my dad went to the military for World War II. So he had a different set of skills than those that didn't go to the military. So he was able to get a job in construction in San Jose. So we had a place, we rented a house in Morgan Hill. So we stayed there. But in the summertime and school breaks and stuff like that, I was always go with my grandmother who would take us working. That's how we grew up from about 1900s to the 1965 thereabouts. Because little by little, they started selling those orchards into ranchettes. Or selling them for development, or selling them for other, other purposes and stuff like that, for industry. And all the ranches that we worked at and on our, you know, the different seasons and stuff like that just disappeared. So the majority of our member moved to the Fresno, Hanford, Madera area, where agriculture was still a lot of agriculture, farms and growing there, and our people continue to work. After 1965, when they sold the lands, a lot of our people transitioned. Well, they lived in the valley now. Very few of our people were able to continue to live in Santa Clara County, for example, and very few lived in Santa Cruz County. And the ones that did were normally usually the ones who did go to the military. For example, we have a couple families that went to work in the shipyards in Oakland because they had been in the Navy in World War II. And others went to the Presidio in Monterey and worked there because they were in the military as well. But we have in the 1980s, our tribe started to form a formal tribal government because we were not a federally recognized tribe. And that's one part of the history I forgot. Our tribe signed a treaty in 1851. Our tribe signed a treaty with the United States. And that treaty went to, after we signed it, the commissioners, the who were negotiating that treaty, the commissioners from the Department of the Military, they went to Washington to be ratified, but the state of California passed a resolution asking that the treaty not be ratified and asking that the president and the U.S. Senate not sign the treaty. And so with that, it went to Washington, D.C., and after a period of lobbying by California, the president ordered that that treaty be sealed for 50 years. So, you know, in the Bay Area, there's a lot of federally unrecognized tribes. Well, the reason that we are unrecognized is because the state of California sabotaged our treaty and that the president ordered that that treaty be sealed for 50 years. So that is why. So they developed a system to try to have tribes seek federal recognition. And so in the 1980s, our tribe started to form a formal government as required. But that federal recognition process, you know, it was developed passed in 1978. Only one California tribe has been recognized under that system. And that was the Timbashaw Shoshone, which is a desert tribe with the Arizona border. And no other tribe has been recognized since then. So we want to, you know, today we're not actively seeking recognition because that system is horribly flawed and we can never be recognized under it. The criteria for recognition has never been validated, and it's impossible to meet. So our tribe, you know, in the year 2001, the tribal elders came to me and asked me to run for tribal chair. In our culture, when the elders speak, it's not really an ask or a polite, will you consider? It's a directive. When the elders come to you and they'll ask you, but that's just a passive directive because that means that you will run for chair. And so I did run for chair. My name was the only one on the ballot and I won. And I became chair. And then in 2006, the tribal elders come to tribal council. And they say, our creation story tells us that it's our responsibility to take care of Mother Earth and all living things. And they say, we have to find a way to get back to that. And the elders told us that. And again, when the elders tell you, it's not an ask. It's a way. You have to find a way to get back on our lands. Well, that was really difficult because our tribe was very poor. At that time, you know, I mean, most of our people were living at or below poverty. We do not live in our territory. So many of our people could not even afford the gas money to drive to our territory. So how in the world are we going to take care of these lands? And when we look at these lands, it's no trespassing, keep out, private property, you know, and all these other things. And so, you know, we're saying, how are we going to take care of the lands when we don't even have access? But that doesn't, but again, when the elders talk to you, you have to find a way. So we did what our tribe always did. We prayed and we asked Creator to help us find a way to get back on our lands and to be able to fulfill our obligation to Creator and to honor our ancestors and to continue on the path of our ancestors. It wasn't long after that that we got a invite from the superintendent of Pinnacles National. At the time it was Monument, now it's Park. He invited us to come on in and talk to him. He had just transferred in from another park where he had a wonderful relationship with the tribe. And he said he wanted to have that same relationship with our tribe at Pinnacles. And we were really happy about that. But at the same time, it worried us, you know, it was scary, very scary for us. Because he wanted us to come in and talk about how to steward the lands and how to restore the lands and how to bring back indigenous stewardship and stuff like that. But the truth is, we went through those three periods of brutal colonization. And each period, they wanted to destroy our culture. They wanted to destroy our spirituality, our indigenous knowledge. They wanted to destroy our environments and all that. And so it was embarrassing to realize that we had lost 90, 95% of our indigenous knowledge. And now somebody's asking us to come on in and apply it, and we had lost it. And so we talked about it at Tribal Council, and Tribal Council says, we have to realize that it's not our fault. It is not our fault that we lost that knowledge. If you look at that history, it's not our fault. They said, but also we have to realize that we have an obligation to relearn and restore that knowledge, to get that knowledge back so that we can honor our ancestors and that we can fulfill our obligation to Creator. So since 2006, that's what our tribe has been working on. And we've been working very hard on that. And we explained that to the park manager, saying that we're going to have to, you know, we want to do this, but you have to realize that we lost a lot of that knowledge, and we're going to get it back. And so they started working with us, and they've been working with us since that. But word soon got out what we were doing at Pinnacles, and then State Parks talked to us. And the Bureau of Land Management talked to us, and city parks and county parks and land trust and open space districts, they started contacting us. And they wanted to work with us, and they wanted us to come back on the lands and start applying the indigenous stewardship. At the same time, about 2006, UC Berkeley was working on was starting a archaeological field school, and they're going to do some intensive research at a place called Quiroste Valley, and they started working on Quiroste Valley, and we started working with them, and they employed our members to work as archaeological field techs. And our people started working there, and we started realizing how much there was to learn about archaeology. They weren't digging up the remains, but they were looking for the seed plants that were there. They were looking at how indigenous people used fire, what their food resources were, and try to learn about what else they could learn from there. And my gosh, we learned a tremendous amount from that research. And that research continued for many years. You know, I mean, for example, they found a lot of tobacco seeds in that in a fire pit, but tobacco doesn't grow on the coast. So we know that there are trade routes and such like that. So we know that in the future, we'll be, need to do research to identify where those trade routes are, and so we can study them and learn more. We also learned what that our people use fire every 5, 10, 7 years, and they would do regular burns, and that right there is kept the coastline of Santa of the Greater Monterey Bay was actually a coastal prairie. And it was the one of the most biodiverse landscapes in North America. And that's because of the way our people stewarded it and managed it. The earlier explorers, when they looked at the landscape, they said, you know, that, that it was just a beautiful, that it was just a beautiful collection of a lot of different plants and a lot of different colors. And they thought that that just happened naturally. They said it was a park-like setting. That's another thing they said, that it was like a park-like setting, the landscapes that were there. And they thought it was just accidental. They didn't realize that the indigenous people had stewarded and managed it so that it became that landscape. When they came in, they outlawed burning. And when they outlawed burning, you know, it was burning that maintained that coastal prairie. And whenever they stopped burning, then the shrubs and then the trees started encroaching and coming on. And today, that coastal prairie and all that biodiversity is pretty much lost along the coast. Little by little, our tribe started to understand how we wanted to move forward. We wanted to move forward so that we could, start to restore that coastal prairie, restore the condition, our food plants, our medicine plants, our basketry plants, etc. We wanted to protect our cultural resources that were there. We wanted to protect our identify and protect and conserve our spiritual sites and our cultural sites. We started working with those other partners and stuff like that. And today we have access to over 140,000 acres within the territories of the Awaswas, the Santa Cruz speaking people, and the Mutsin, the Mutsin speaking people. We work, you know, and then we developed a land trust in 2012. And the four goals of our land trust are to protect and conserve our cultural and sacred sites, to do research. But then the research is not just on the archaeology. The research is to start to do research on the true history of the Mutsin history and the California Indian history. You heard parts of that today when I was talking about our history. You know, we want to learn our true history. We want to teach our true history. We want that history told in our schools and in parks and in the cities and the counties, et cetera. You know, and then so, you know, research and then education. You know, we participate in a lot of education events to the public. Part of tonight's talk is education. And then we also developed a Native Stewardship Corps. And the Native Stewardship Corps, we have young adults who work on the landscapes, and most of the times they're living in tents and they're working, they work very hard every day, but they're working, currently they're working at a location that Quiroste Valley I mentioned earlier. You know, they're cutting down a lot of trees and they're restoring that coastal prairie there. They're cutting down the trees, opening up the valley, and then we're bringing in native plants. We had This was our first year of doing plant propagation. We had 120,000 plants that we propagated in the greenhouse, and then we planted them. But those 120,000, you know, 90,000 or so are going to be to, you know, to use as seed producers. So we're, you know, we're going to grow them in an agricultural field, but then we're going to get the seeds from there. And we're going to start restoring them out into the traditional landscapes. And, you know, and those plants, of course, are the native plants of our foods and medicines, et cetera. So that's what we do today. Our people work very hard. Our tribe is comprised of over 600 members today. We're very lucky in the sense that in our last traditional leader, her name was Ascension Solorizano. She was visited by a person from the Smithsonian Institute just before she passed. And that's her, Ascension Solorizano. And the person at the Smithsonian Institute, she talked to him and she provided him it's reported to be 78,000 pages of anthropological field notes. And those field notes, a lot of those right there, she was a doctora, a healer, so she knew the plants. So she left a lot of information about the plants, but she also knew the songs, the ceremonies, the places of power. She talked about the relationships of our tribe to other tribes and our language, et cetera. So she's a wonderful lady, just a wonderful lady and a true gift to us from Creator, Ascension. And she's what's going to allow us to restore 90 to 95% of our knowledge. So that's kind of, I can stop there and take some questions. Our tribe works hard every day. And our tribal members. Well, let me talk about one more thing. I'm sorry to do this to you, but I want to add one more thing. And that right there is talk about healing. You know, I mean, that history brought on to what's known as historic trauma, generation after generation. You know, when you're going living through periods of slavery during the mission period, and then the Mexican period, it was just slavery and brutality again. And the Mexican period, just sheer fright of every day wanting to just struggle to have survival. How do you raise children so that they're have hope, so they're be optimistic, so know that they are very good, that they're important and they're very valuable? How do you raise children to have love and to know who they are, to be proud of who they are? How do you raise children to know their purpose for being here and knowing and to having good balance in their life? The answer is you don't. You don't do that with children. Children don't grow that way. Grow up and that in those kinds of environments that just doesn't happen. And so, you know, and that resulted in what's called historic trauma. And historic trauma is to where people grew up, you know, with a lot of hopelessness, a lot of sadness, a lot of loss, etc. And that results in depression, suicide, addiction, incarceration, violence, and our people grew up with all of that. And it's a horrible thing. It's a horrible thing. If you listen to Lou when he read my bio, you saw that I was a Native American advisor to the National Alliance on Mental Illness. You know, I have a son with a serious mental illness. And all I could do was cry and pray. And I said, something, we have to find a better way to deal with this. And that's when I discovered NAMI. And so I deal a lot with men, you know, I learned about mental illness and I became a trainer in mental illness. And our members know that, so our members would call me whenever they deal with issues. Well, in 1 week, I got 4 calls. And those 4 calls, you know, were all from members, you know, dealing with addiction, dealing with incarceration and other issues. You know, and I'm sitting in my bed, I would go thinking, how are we going to be a successful tribe if we're just dealing with these issues? We gotta find a way to address this. And so 13 years ago, we started having bi-monthly wellness meetings. We have a tribal psychiatrist there and a tribal psychologist there. At first, we started to restore identity, our indigenous identity of who our tribe is, what our spirituality, traditional spirituality is, what our culture is, our traditional ways, our practices, et cetera, our songs, our language. We started restoring that. And then we started dealing with individual problems like addiction and suicide and rape and molestation. We deal with hard subjects at our wellness meetings. We have a tribal psychiatrist and 2 tribal psychologists at all our meetings because they get pretty heavy. But we can have 70 to 120 members attending our wellness meetings. And those are, there have been the best things that we have done as a tribe, address wellness and healing from that historic trauma. One thing we learned in historic trauma in our classes, well, let me tell you how that came about. You know, it seems like our youth did not know how to pick a mate. Our people were picking, somebody just got out of prison and they, have a history of abusing their spouse or their girlfriends and they're back on drugs again. You know, I mean, how, you know, there are people would say, well, I can fix that person or he'll treat me different or he'd never do that to me. You know, then they get in a relationship. Next thing you know, they're in the hospital or they're, it's just horrible stuff that happened to our youth. And so we gotta teach our people how to pick mates better. How to pick mates better. And so we started talking about how to pick a mate. How many of you guys have ever taken an event on how to pick a mate, you know? But we had that. It was gonna be a one-time meeting, it turned into 3 meetings. But that was a popular meeting too. We had a lot of people, the grandmothers were there telling the youngs how to do it and stuff like that. But what we learned in the end, it's pretty simple. What we learned in the end is to have a healthy relationship. It takes 2 healthy people. You know, how can you have a healthy relationship if one person is not healthy, if they're not honest, if they're on drugs, if they do crimes and stuff like that? I mean, how could that be a healthy relationship? It takes 2 healthy people to have a healthy relationship. And so we started talking about how do you get yourself healthy? And how do you recognize healthy qualities in others? This is really important for our members. We had a lot of our young adult, our teenagers and youngsters attending these meetings. And they were really involved in this. They wanted to know. And such. But then we talked about it a little beyond that, because now we talk about having relationships outside of our tribe. And so whenever how do we as a tribe have a relationship with the state, with the cities, with the counties? We say we only want healthy relationships. Well, shouldn't that city and that county and the state be healthy? If we're going to have a healthy relationship with the church, shouldn't that church be healthy? And what does it mean for the church, you know, for these other entities to be healthy? Shouldn't they tell the truth? Shouldn't they trust us? Today, shouldn't they recognize that history and try to help us restore our cultures and protect our cultural resources and acknowledge the impacts of cultural, of historic trauma and help us with our healing of our members? None of that happens. How can we have healthy relationships that people aren't going to tell the truth, et cetera? So we say to have healthy relationships, it takes two healthy people or two healthy entities. And so today we talk to a lot of people about the need for perpetrators to heal. The perpetrators have a lot more healing than our people do. A lot more healing than the Native people do. The perpetrators do. They are the ones that they're collecting bounty monies. They are the ones that were paying bounty monies. They are the ones that were enslaving the people. They have a lot more healing than our people. So I'm going to stop there. Those are just the kinds of things that our tribe deals with and looks at and talks about. Some of it is hard. I know that this is a hard history to hear. I do honestly believe that all Indigenous people share the same history in one form or another. And, you know, the examples will be different and stuff like that. But we all have the same thing. We have the same historic trauma. And we're all looking for ways to move forward in healthy ways. So with that, I'll stop and I'll take questions. Thank you very much.
Everybody can raise their hands or just unmute, right? It's not very large crowd. Maybe we can handle it. We have some questions were in the chat room. I guess maybe we can go up. One question was from Suzanne Mantegi. Do you want to repeat your question, Suzanne?
Sure. Hi, Chief Lopez. This is Suzanne Mantegi from South County Democratic Club. You know, I have heard you speak to us few times, and every time I learn something new. But the question is what is next for your tribe or all the tribes? You know, we know what has happened. So what is next? What is really you're looking for to do for your community and the impact that your community you're expecting to have on state of California?
Well, thank you, Suzanne. Let me start to say about what we're hoping for in the short term, and we're asking for people's support here, and we're asking for the county to recognize this, is that currently our most sacred site, Uristock, at the south end of Gilroy, that's our most sacred site. We had ceremonies there for thousands of years. And at this site, there's a lot of cultural materials and burials. And now there's a proposal with Santa Clara County to do sand and gravel mining. They want to tear down our four most sacred mountains and dig a big pit in the ground for sand and gravel. And we're asking the county to deny that mining permit. And how can, you know, and such like that. So, you know, I mean, how can the county be considered healthy and have a healthy relationship with the Native people if they're going to let our sacred sites be destroyed? You know, so we're asking people to recognize that and to help our tribe protect its most sacred site. And you know, that's one thing. But then we're asking the big thing we're asking of the state, of the cities, and the counties is to tell the truth. Tell the truth about our history. You know, and to recognize that. And to recognize that the state of California sabotaged our treaties. And can they help us, restore a land base, for example? I know that the governor put out that, you know, that they want the excess lands that the state has, you know, to find a way to have them come to the tribe. But we talked to Caltrans about a 14-acre parcel, and they say they can make a lot of money if they sell it, and so they don't want to work a deal with the tribe. Well, they didn't use those words exactly, but that was their message, you know, that they want to sell that land, and they would, if we want to pay the market value, then they'd consider it. But we, you know, we're a poor tribe. We don't have that. So, you know, I mean, telling the truth, helping us restore our culture, helping us restore our spiritualities, those are big steps. Those are real big steps. And the other thing is for the perpetrators to recognize that they healed. I know in 2015, Pope Francis apologized to the indigenous peoples of the Americas for the sins, the crimes, and the offenses of the Catholic Church. That's what the Pope apologized for. And we wrote him a letter and said, our tribe does not accept apologies. You know, I mean, apologies to us just means now will you, you know, we apologize, so will you please shut up? That's all we hear. You know, we told them that not many of us, including myself, we grew up Catholic. And we learned that to be forgiven for your sins, you have to first confess your sins. You have to say what you did, why you did it, how many times you did it. You have to do penance, and then you have to atone for your sins. You know, and we told in the letter that I wrote to the Pope, you know, I said, you know, I mean, if the church wants to be forgiven for its sins, that's what it must do. So those are just some thoughts along this line. But telling the truth and, you know, denying the mining permit and helping us protect other cultural resource sites that have not been disturbed yet, help us protect them from destruction and help us find a way to get back to our lands so that we can, you know, as a tribe, we can move forward as a tribe.
Somebody has raised the hand, Castle.
Yes, thank you. Chief Lopez, thank you for speaking. I made a comment in the chat and I wanted to make sure it gets read and also ask you the question just about your history. With the level of respect for the land and the connection you've demonstrated, I cannot imagine the level of gratitude that existed back then for a creator. Mass gratitude is a higher level of awareness that comes from greater spirituality. I'm terribly sorry for the lack, for the loss of this level of spirituality within your ancestors. I'm wondering how different regions within California related to each other and if they got along or were there issues between the cultures.
I am not familiar with there being, you know, I mean, we did not, there is no empire building here. There is no invasion of other territory. We had real strict protocols. The only way you would go on a neighboring tribe's territory is if, for example, if you shot a deer and the deer didn't die immediately and it crossed over into another tribe's land, you can go on into the next tribe's land to retrieve that deer and go back. And to keep that deer from suffering. That was a big part, to keep that deer from suffering. But other than that, if you want to cross into another territory, you know, there was protocols that you would do to get permission. And the permission was usually granted. Another important, you know, so there was no territory fights or border fights or anything like that. Creator defined our territories and we knew where we belonged. The other thing is, do you ever look at the Californians, a lot of them, the women have tattoos on their faces, and particularly their chins. Those are there give their lineage, you know. And this way here, whenever you pick a mate, you're not picking a cousin or a relative, you know. And so we have ceremonies. We had that are called big time. We had a big time ceremony in San Juan Bautista, probably about 8 years ago. We had a big time there. And big times are when many, many tribes come together. And that's for the purpose of finding a mate. And so those big times would go on for 3 or 4 weeks. And at the end, most people would go home. But whenever if a woman and if a couple got together, a man and a woman or a girl, you know, an older teen and a boy or girl, and they got together, the boy would always go with the male would always go with the female tribe. And that's the way it was. And so now the neighboring tribes are all your relatives based on that and such like that. So there was no territorial disputes or anything like that. And there was no You know, no wars. It could be some family issues, but not tribal issues that I'm aware of, that I've ever heard of. Does that answer the question of satisfactory, Kessel?
It does. Thank you. And I wish we could learn from your ancestors today.
This is Tony Koshaba from the Syrian Democrats. What we can offer, you know, is that we kind of even add more educational events so that you are as immigrants here on this land, right? A land of your ancestors. At least our children also have a more appreciation of your culture and history. At least that's what we can do. We can create more awareness, have more events, and in our cultural events, we kind of invite the native tribes to come and talk about their cultures or show part of that, right? And also with regard to asking the, as a group, as an organized group here in Nekani, we can ask the government officials to appreciate and to kind of honor your request, right, for protecting your stack or other issues. Thank you again.
And I agree with that completely. Thank you.
Helen Talia, I can go. I have a question. It's very long, though, so forgive me, everyone.
Okay, go ahead.
My question is to Honorable Lopez. Do you counsel natives outside of the state of California? Because I work with orphaned natives, Native American teens being phased out from state custody in the state of Arizona with little to no skills and education, many of whom are traumatized from birth to being shuffled from one foster home to another. Our program tries to intercept them from going into the streets at the turn of the age of 18, many of whom are turning to streets for drugs, gangs, incarceration, teen pregnancies, et cetera. I would love your thoughts and even participation somewhere down the future. Obviously the program right now is pending COVID situation, but it's commonly held at the American Indian College in the city of Phoenix. Thank you.
That's a horrible situation, you know, whenever people age out of that foster care system, and yet it's just a horrible transition. You know, Helen, our Native Stewardship Corps, we call that, you know, I mean, our members who work there now are, you know, have some tough backgrounds. I mean, some really tough backgrounds and such like that. And this right here has really changed their life. And the intent for our Stewardship Corps is for youth like that to come on in and start, you know, living with the indigenous people, we pay a good salary, they get benefits, medical, etc., and they work hard every day, but they pray every day. We have ceremonies, we have sweats, we have talking circles where we talk about healing and all that for our stewards and for, you know, and such. And so I would like to see our program welcome the foster care youth who want to come on in, who want to change their life, who want to find another path to come on and do that. It would be very disruptive to our program, as you can imagine, if they weren't ready to accept that from a hard work point or from a cultural. So it would be interesting to explore this further, Helen. And I would encourage you to contact me.
I will, because right now the most that we can offer them is job skills and also financial literacy.
Yeah.
That's the most we're able to do, right? Not being Native Americans, we're not able to offer them much the support that would commonly come from their roots.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I will contact you, and I appreciate it. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Helen. Bill James has raised his hand.
Yes, Chair Lopez. I'm Bill James. I'm chair of the Santa Clara County Democratic Party. We've met because I know you've spoken to our group a couple of years back when we passed our original resolution supporting the initiative to protect Eurostack. And I want to thank Lou for coming to our meeting recently and giving us an update on that effort. As Susan was mentioning, we stand ready to act on the resolution that we've adopted. And we can write another letter and contact our supervisors again, help you with the campaign, reaching out to them, especially as you get to moments like this where there seems to be a decision-making time. Because of the, I know you touched only on the greatest highlights of the long history of the Ohlone people and what's happened to them since Europeans came to this place. And, but it seems like together, if we could help the Amamutsin people do this one thing in a very symbolic way to make amends, I think that we would be very happy to be able to do that. So please keep us in mind, especially as you get to decision-making time and you start doing your counts and you think you maybe have two votes and need a third one on the Board of Supervisors, and we'd be very happy to help you, with the little campaign of outreach to make the right thing happen.
That's wonderful to hear, Bill. Thank you very much for offering that. The draft EIR, as you know, will be out soon. And so we will be asking for letters of support and at the public hearings with the planning commissioner and then with the Board of Supervisors, as we anticipate there will be an appeal. There again, we'll ask for the public to show up, because we were told the only thing that will stop that mining permit from being approved with overwhelming public support. And so that's what we're hoping to have. So your offer is very generous and very much appreciated, Bill. Thank you.
Well, thank you for today.
Any other questions? We are 8:30. We promised to do 1 hour and 30 minutes. We are right on time. Our club also had kind of prepared the presentation about, how we kind of think of relating Assyrian issues with the Native American issues. But I think we will leave that to another time. And hopefully we'll invite all the attendees to come and attend that presentation too at another time. And also we will kind of push for, have our own resolution. Hopefully other clubs will join us so that this way Bill James will have more momentum to kind of push at the county level on these issues. Thank you so much. If there is no other questions, I guess we can end our meeting.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you very much. Good night now.
Thank you
so much. Good night, everybody.
Good night. Thank you, Honorable Lopez.
Welcome.
Thank you, the Honorable Lopez.
Thank you for everything.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much. This was a wonderful presentation.
Thank you for attending, Doreen.
It was wonderful to be here. Thank you for presenting, and thank you so much for this education that we will be active and activist to help with.
Very good. ADWA members can stay. Maybe we'll talk about the resolution that we have. The rest, the other guests, they can leave if they want.